Brothers and sisters, good day. I want to welcome you to another Sunday reflection. And of course, look at it. We are already in the last Sunday of February. 2 months have come to an end in this new year. Wow. And so the time is moving so quickly. And we have to, you know, continue to trust God, look to Him for His grace and for His mercy to sustain us so that we'll fulfill His promises. So we welcome you to another Sunday reflection. Trust that the word shared with you will be life transforming. Oh boy, we are living in such serious times, but we have to keep our eyes on the eastern sky, the Bible says, the song says, and look up because our redemption draw nigh. I want to welcome you from the Mount Zion Pastoral Church of Mount Zion Congregation, Lilliput and Barrytown, and of course, Farmites by extension, and to trust that as you come, that God will speak peace to your soul. I want to commence with a song, very, what I would call, historic ancient song. And again, we are using the group Bonem, singing by the rivers of Babylon.
Remember Zion.
Babylon, there he sat down and there he remembered Zion. Babylon was never a good place. Father, we just thank you for releasing us and giving us the opportunity to free ourselves through Jesus Christ, from the restrictive forces of the systems of corruption, carnality, and oppression. And Father, as we reflect on your word today, we pray that you will open our eyes that we may see, remove the scales from our eyes. And Lord, we pray for those that are still under oppressive system, those under oppressive system in our nations of the world, that you will free them, free their minds. Oh God Almighty, we pray for freedom in Haiti, freedom in Ukraine, freedom, oh God, for those in Syria, Turkey, freedom from bondage, from oppression, from, oh God, those things that hold them back. Even our own country, we pray for freedom, oh God Almighty, from the things that hold us and restrict us. Oh God Almighty, this freedom from the powers of evil, from sicknesses and bandages. Oh God, let your power break through the forces of darkness and set the oppressed, the captive free. Oh God Almighty, I pray that you will let your Holy Spirit speak to us powerfully and transform us, Lord, in a mighty and powerful way. Those who are held to the captive power of sin, demonic oppression, we ask you to set them free. In Jesus' name, by your power, by your Spirit, heal them and set them free. Now, in Jesus' name, let your word speak hope to them. In Jesus' name. Brothers and sisters, we just cannot sing the Lord's song in a strange land. All right? And so we have to step out if we're going to free ourselves. Hallelujah. I want to share with us today, brothers and sisters, from a passage of scripture, Revelation 18 and verse 1 to verse 5. That's Revelation 18, verse 1 to 5. And John is speaking and says, and after these things, I saw another angel came down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are wax rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that he be not partakers of her sins, and that he receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. This is the word of Almighty God. Father, may you bless your word to our heart and glorify your name. I want to share with us a simple thought, though powerful today. Leave Babylon. And it's against the backdrop because that materialism has taken over our lives and have taken over our nations of the world, that people have become so selfish, greedy, and have allowed money to characterize their lives, not recognizing that it is a subtle system of Babylonianism that controls them. Now, Babylon and the word Babel are terms in common and mean organized rebellion against God. While the beginning of this prehistoric city of Babylon / Babel dates as far back as Genesis 10, under the leadership of Nimrod, Genesis 10 verse 10, which reads, "And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, and Enoch, and Enoch, and Akkad, and Calne, in the land of Shinar," speaking of Nimrod, who established this first city, as you know, the Tower of Babel, where they were trying to build up a tower to reach up to the kingdom of God after the antediluvian age, after the flood, so that they were saying that we're trying to avoid God. Now, while historic Babylon and the Babylonian Empire became the mistress of Babylon under the reign of one king, Hammurabi, it really reached the highest glory in the 6th century BC under the reign and kingship of Nebuchadnezzar. And a lot of people would have read of Nebuchadnezzar reaching its largest, most splendid capital of all times. Babylon was the envy of the other nations of the world because of its fortification. Now, as expressed in Daniel 4 and verse 29 to 30, where the Bible says, "At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon," speaking of Nebuchadnezzar. And verse 30 says, "And the king spoke and said, Is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of kingdom by the might of my power and the honor of my majesty?" And you know that this was a self-glorification of a man, Nebuchadnezzar, who said that this is great Babylon that I have built. Then you would have read what happened to him after. He was sent out in the field for 7 years to eat of the grass of the field until his nails grew like that of animals. And he was there until he recognized who was true God. Now, a gentleman by the name of Herodotus stated that Babylon, in its physical structure, was in square about 14 miles in length. Wow, that's a big city. And if you want to know more of its fortification, you can read more under the topic of historic Babylon to see how fortified this place was. In its etymology, the Hebrew writers see the word Babylon / Babel as coming from the root word Belal, which means confused and confounded, for there the Lord confounded them and confused their language. If you know that while they were building the Tower of Babel and God says, "Come, let us go down there now," and they confound their language, because see, they have organized themselves and nothing will be standing in their ways. And so God confused and confounded them so that they became separated. Now, from earliest times, Babylon was conceived as the emblem of human splendor and rebellion against God, right? So Babylon was always viewed as that city of pride and ambition, and they were destined to fall because of the evil, as Sodom and Gomorrah was evil and was destined to fall. So Babylon was always destined to fall. Babylon Babel from earliest times portrays the vanity of human self-glorification and the failure of humankind when they refuse to depend on God and instead depend on themselves. Though historic Babylon was destroyed in 539 BC by the legendary King Cyrus the Great, and which fall was completed when the entire empire came under Persian control, Babylon must be viewed not just as a historic city, neither just as a physical, economic, geopolitical nation, but more so as an evil system which continues to permeate and to influence the human society in an evil way throughout history. So though Babylon is destroyed, there's a subtle way in which the system of Babylon exists and continues to permeate human society through organizations, societies, through orchestrated plans to suppress, to oppress, to corrupt brothers and sisters. The original intent of Babylon was to create a substitute for God, and so by extension means a temple or shrine or house of idols to substitute the Creator God. And that is what is precisely what is happening in the world. People want to substitute God. They want to substitute God's law. They want to lay down their own rules. They want to set their own standards. And there is nothing that they want to be in their way to prevent them from being evil and from being corrupt. Nothing to play on their conscience, but that won't stop it. That is Babylon. Now, in essence then, the intended objective is to organize rebellion against God and to establish their own order and system so they could rule out God and his laws, which would lead to self-governance. Man want to govern themselves and to govern themselves in a way that there is no law that should allow them to feel uncomfortable in their wrongs. Now, tradition and folklore, even thought of Nimrod, who is the first builder of Babylon and the instigator of Babel, they thought of his wife, Samaries, as the first high priestess of idolatry and the mother of Edenism and the paganistic system of idolatry. So the man was so evil that his very wife was seen as the instigator and the originator of Edenism and paganistic system of idolatry. The introduction of the concept of polytheism, as an example, which is the worship of many gods, was at the heart of the objective of Babel or Babylon, where the human quest was to have many gods manifesting themselves into what we see today in our society and throughout history. One, we see people who glorify and deify things like sex, brothers and sisters, the god of money. Money is a thing which controls so many people today. The god of materialism, the god of self, the god of intellectualism, the god of status symbol, where people think that these things are the end all and the be all in themselves. But no matter how many of these things we have, they cannot satisfy. Money does not satisfy. Materialism does not satisfy that spiritual need in the human heart. Sex does not satisfy. Status symbols, when we try to portray ourselves as being powerful, being great and wealthy, does not satisfy. It's a subtle system of Babylonianism that has controlled the society, and it is evil. It is the spring of hell. This is what the writer in the epistle to the Romans meant when he says in Romans 1, verse 21 to 23, he says, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they become fools. And verse 23 says, and change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible man, and to birds, and to four-footed beasts, and creeping things. It is interesting to see people don't want to worship and serve God, but they will serve their dogs and their cats and their birds and their things, and they worship their cars and the latest version, and how many of them they have. Oh my God, brothers and sisters, which these things are vanity and vexation of spirit, is a subtle system of Babylon that is permeating the society. In our times, we see people worship clothes, shoes, cars, house, money, sex, parties, fine dining, raree and bling bling. Every latest style and fashion, they are in it, brothers and sisters. And they put these things over God, over their religious life, over their deliverance. They substitute God for these things, because some of them will avoid going to church because of their parties, of their sports, of all of these things. We must recognize that these things are material and they do not last. Amen. Babylonian systems still prevail. And it is about the me, it's about the I, it's about myself. There is no God in it. In the equation, there is no God. And it is characterized by selfishness and characterized by greed. God has always commanded his people throughout through the prophets to detest Babylonianism, to detest Babel, to detest Babylonian practices as a proud paganistic, idolatrous, socially and spiritually depraved, materialistic, oppressive civil system that is and was and will always be up in opposition to God and his moral standard. In Revelation 17 and verse 1 to 6 depicts the system as a system of perversion, of religious apostasy, of occultic apostate Protestantism, paganistic in nature. The writer views it as the spring of all evil, coming from the mystery scarlet woman referred to here in Revelation 17, which is an all-embracing city who reign over the kings of the earth. And it is speaking of a nation that has influence over the kings of the earth, but at the same time, what it is issuing out of its system, its corruption, it is evil. She is drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the Christians, portrayed of the Christians, and they are drinking the blood of the martyrs of Jesus Christ, always killing, opposing, resisting morality, spirituality, and God. It is fleshy, it is carnal, it is satanic in nature, and materialistic. It is Babylonianism, and the Bible says we should get out of it. Oh yes, it's operating a mystery, but we have to unravel it and realize that it is right here before us. In Revelation 17, verse 2, verse 4 to 5, yes, 4 and 5, the Bible says, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Verse 4, and the woman was arrayed in purple and in scarlet. You see, I'm telling you about these material things, and a scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, and having a golden cup in her hand, full of the abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Some of the terms I use figuratively, but you can see that it's about material things, that the system is about material things. I read that again for you. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, and having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon, the great, the mother of harlots, and the abomination of the earth. So you see, the system is issuing from a nation, but it has influences over other nations. And what are they issuing? Corruption, materialism, about money, it's about corruption, it's about greed. It's just Babylonianism. And the Bible is telling us in Revelation 8 and verse 4, John says, he heard a voice saying, come out of her. Yes, come out of her. Don't allow the world and its practices to suck you in and to sap you in with all the corruption and the material quests that people have. Revelation 8 and verse 18 and verse 4. As I read the actual text, it says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. You see, there are so many of us who will destroy each other because of money and because of power and because of all of these things. But the Bible says you must come out of her, come out of Babylon. The call issues to the believers is for them to step out of Babylon, though thus separating themselves from this historic system of evil that intends to corrupt their soul and lead us astray from God. Failure to separate from this system will lead to one becoming part of her sins, and therefore will be ultimately receive part of her judgment, for God has not forgotten her iniquity, and she is destined for destruction. You see, there is a subtle system of Babylon that wants to mix religion and righteousness with evil and corruption, but the Bible says we should come out of her. Jeremiah 17 and verse 18, read in Jeremiah 17 and verse 18, Jeremiah is writing and he says, let them be confounded that persecute me, but let not me be confounded. Let them be dismayed, but let not me be dismayed. Bring upon them the day of evil and destroy them with double destruction. Is that Babylon is destined for destruction. In Jeremiah 50 and verse 29, Jeremiah says, call together the archers against Babylon. All you that bend the bow, camp against it round about. Let none escape thereof. Recompense her according to her work, according to all that she has done. Do unto her, for she has been proud against the Lord, the Holy One of Israel. And that's what it is about, that people are proud, lift up themselves against God, exalt themselves against the Most High in heaven. And the Bible says they are destined for destruction. We are warned to come out of her, to step out of Babylon. When we are walking in Babylon, brothers and sisters, and when we are part of the system as we see in the world today, when we allow ourselves to be one with the corrupt system of the world, and everything they are doing, we do it. Every party they are having, we go. Everything they are eating, we eat it. Everything they are drinking, we drink it. Everything they are wearing, we wear it. Every word they are speaking, we speak it. Every song they sing, we sing it. When we are part of the system and there is no separation, remember the Bible says, but you are a chosen generation, your royal priesthood, your holy nation, call out of the world to show forth the praises of God. There has to be a separation. And that's what the Lord is calling. When he says come out of her, he's calling for separation. Those who are part of the system and allow the system to absorb them. Brothers and sisters, though we come to church, we cannot truly worship God. Because if you're part of the Babylonian system, if you're part of the world, everything the world is doing, you're doing it. And when I talk the world, I want to be very clear that we're not talking about the cosmos. And I will reiterate that. In Psalm 137, verse 1 to 3, the psalmist is writing, matter of fact, verse 1 to 5, I should say, or 4, thereabout. The people were at the river of Babylon, which is historic Babylon. It says, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hang our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, Sing us a song of Zion. Verse 4, How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Those who are part of the system of Babylon, and you try to mix religion and Christianity with the world, the corrupt practices of the world, you cannot truly serve and you cannot truly worship God. For those brothers and sisters who are part of the system and try to worship God, there is divided allegiance and a desire for worldliness and a desire for righteousness. It does not work. Brothers and sisters, we have to step out, because if you're still dabbling in the system of Babylon, you cannot truly worship God. We have a form of godliness, but deny the real power thereof. It's just a form, because God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The Bible even says that if we're going to follow Christ, we must deny ourselves and we should take up the cross daily and follow him. You cannot mix Babylonianism with Christianity. It does not work. You cannot truly serve and worship God. That's why the people that were at the river of Babylon hung their harps upon the willows in the midst thereof, and they could not sing the Lord's song in a strange land. If you are in the system of Babylon, you cannot sing the Lord's song. You sing some songs, but it is not God's song. It's not the song of Jerusalem. It's not the song of heaven. You are singing, but you are singing by the, you are going through the motion. You are not singing from the heart as unto the Lord, because you are half-hearted. You have Babylonian in your blood, Babylonianism in your blood, in your system, and you breathe it, you live it, and you walk in it. Those who are part of the system cannot truly worship God, so we need to step out. Secondly, those who are part of the system of Babylon cannot be in a true relationship with God, because you cannot be serving God and serving mammon. You cannot be serving God and serving the corruption that is in the world. You cannot be serving God and yet you're secular. You're dabbling in what the world is dabbling in, as if you envy them for what they have. You cannot do both at the same time. It is either one or the other. You cannot jack on the fence, brothers and sisters. It said, James 1 and verse 4 say, You adulteresses and adulteresses, know you not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. 1 John 2 and verse 15 says, Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And this is not talking about the ecology or cosmos based on the Greek word. It's not talking about the birds and the trees and the beauty of the world. It is talking about worldliness, a worldly system, worldly practices, worldly happenings that corrupt humankind, all of these things, the greed and the scamming and the whatever people are doing in order to get what they want. The Bible says we should love those things, because if we love them, the love of the Father is not in us, because it is going to cause you to kill to get it. It's going to cause you to do wicked things to get it, and that cannot be of God. Yes, brothers and sisters, so we need to step out. If we are going to step out of Babylon, we must understand the mystery of the system that is holding you down. It is a system of deception and corruption which lead that hold us, brothers and sisters. It is subtle. It is what gives you bad mind and envy and jealousy. So we have to understand how it works. We have to understand that it is holding us. It is that which offers competition between persons, that you want to have this and you want to have that, and you want to have what your brother have and what your sister have. And as a consequence, you will compete with them. Brothers and sisters, we bind that power in the name of Jesus Christ, and we need to understand the subtleness of the system and step out. If you're going to step out of Babylon, you must be determined that you are not going to drink of the sap of its evil and get drunk by it. Because there are some people that are drunken by worldliness and worldly practices. They look at the world and they want it. They're not willing to break link and to break ties and to depart from that system and to serve God fully. If you're going to step out of Babylon, we just step out. Come out of her now. Come out of her. Don't be anymore captivated by the things that are lowering. Oppression, brothers and sisters, lowering you, that binds you. But we need to come out in the name of Jesus. Tell yourself, no more oppression. Call upon Jesus Christ and ask him to lift you up, because this call to step out is urgent. Leave Babylon and come, the song says. Don't mind your friend who will laugh you to scorn, because when Christ was here, they do him the very same. Look in your life and see how you live. Leave Babylon and come. Leave Babylon and come to a place of freedom, a place of liberation. Do not let worldly practices, do not let worldly fashion and all these things hold you bound. Come to a level of freedom in your spirit and let us glorify God. Pack your bag. It's time to leave Babylon. We are going to a place of victory, a place of prosperity, a place of blessing. You're going to a place of freedom. Freedom in your mind and in your body, in your financial life. Oh yes, we are calling upon you right now in the name of Jesus to step out of those things that restrict you, hold you back, and prevent you from giving Jesus Christ full 100. We are calling you from a system which corrupts your minds, that is just materialistic, that is just corrupt, that is just paganistic, that is just evil. That system that causes you to be given into the flesh and carnality, the Lord wants you to step out right now. The Lord wants you to step out like right now. The bling bling, the ray ray, and all of these things that hold you bound, that you feel you have to get it, you have to have it in order to survive. John Paul says, with food and raiment, we be content. I command you today, and I challenge you to leave Babylon. Step out of Babylon. Leave the system and serve God with a whole heart, with a whole mind. Don't live pretentiously and live on the periphery of your faith, the surface of your experience with God. Let it be deepened. Come all the way into Jerusalem and let the presence of God hold you fast, because if you continue in that system, you will destroy yourself and you will not enter into God's eternal rest and God's eternal kingdom. Hallelujah. Let me pray for you. Father, there are many who are bound by this subtle system of Babylonianism. I command them now to be loose in the name of Jesus. I pray that those who are held bound by demonic oppression, by satanic oppression, I command them to be loose. I pray that those who are bound, O God Almighty, in bondage, enslaved in their minds and in their thoughts, I pray for them to be loose in the name of Jesus. I pray for those who are under the bondage of sickness. I pray for they be loose in Jesus' name. I pray for those who are in carnality, that God, you may rescue them right now in the name of Jesus, by your power and by your spirit, in Jesus' name. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Shalom, brothers and sisters. Nothing broken, nothing wanting, and nothing lacking in your life. I want to end our reflection this morning with a song from one of our own Jamaican, Marcia Griffiths, a legend in Jamaica. Step out of Babylon, one by one.